the person who's always with us at 2:30 on Monday is Scotty Grayson with his Grayson's Grades. Now, we get on Scott a little bit because we thought he's been a harsh critique of the Eagles, even in wins lately, but not today, man. Santa Claus came to town, and he's giving out A's. A's for Dallas Goedert, A for Greg Ward, A for Miles Sanders, and others. As we welcome in Scotty Grayson from 97.3 ESPN, and of course you can read Grayson's Grades on 97.3ESPN.com right now. Scotty, a lot of A's in your Santa sack.
Yeah, you know, I went into the game thinking I was going to be grading on a little bit of a curve. Like, if things didn't go well, you know, you're going to pay the price a little bit given the weight of that game. And since they did go pretty well for a lot of guys, and obviously the outcome. I mean, leading the whole way for a team that has not done that really with anybody all year, to me, that said a lot. And I felt like you could easily see looking down from where we were up in the press box, Jeff, that the Eagles looked like they wanted it a whole lot more than the Cowboys did throughout the game. And I think a lot of that comes from the head coach and the preparation and the leaders, quite frankly. We heard a lot about it in the locker room afterwards from some of the leaders and the speeches they were given during the week to really get these guys motivated. And it obviously, to me, looked like it paid off.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And the weird thing is, some of the leaders are speaking to players who are literally playing in their first few games of their professional career. And one guy who's really kind of come into his own, you gave an A to, is Miles Sanders, who for the second straight week kind of gives you that Brian Westbrook-like performance. And it became even more of a Westbrook-like performance when he slid at the end because, you know, 11 years ago, probably this week, he did that against Dallas to finish off a win. Scott, what are you seeing from Miles? Just in, I mean, besides the statistical production, what stands out about him to you?
You know, honestly, I think it's the work ethic, the dedication, the good head on his shoulder, the maturity at this point. Quite frankly, you talked about the slide. I mean, that's just knowing the game and knowing that you could pad your stats, go get that touchdown, and with 30 seconds left, it's all but over anyway. But to just slide and let the clock run out and just go on your merry way and try to get one more win to get into the playoffs, I just think the level of maturity that guy is showing and the growth that he's made, you kind of see the correlation between them. He struggled early in the year. We all know that. We saw it. He was hitting holes too quick. He was not patient enough. Just wasn't really letting things unfold in front of him. And now it's a totally different player. He's not a rookie anymore. I keep saying that because I think that this guy, 15 games in, is definitely moving on to the next level. And you could see where this was. Look, how he's rightfully so, I think, ripped for some of the draft picks he's made not panning out. This one was a very solid pick. And I think you can see that as you look at him and play him out for the future to say that they got a really good running back here they can build around with Carson.
Yeah, I mean, if only there were someone here at 97.3 who was advocating for Miles Sanders to be used this way, I don't know, in October. If only there was someone, Scott.
Yeah, I know, right?
Yeah, it's crazy. Dallas Goedert is another guy you gave an A to. Last week, I thought he made the biggest catch of the game against Washington. You remember that J.J. Arcega-Whiteside kind of blew up the route, but he caught the ball one-handed. Huge play. And then, obviously, there was an entire drive, Scott, yesterday where every single pass went to Dallas Goedert. He's really kind of coming up and being that guy that I think a lot of people thought he could be.
Yeah, now with the news today, which was not surprising about Earth, I think you're going to have to see him become that guy again. He has really become reliable, and I think you see every reason why the Eagles jumped up in front of as ironic as it is, in the draft they jumped up in front of the Cowboys to grab him because he knew that they wanted him. So I think that was a great move to grab Goddard. I think he and Ertz have really been a very good 1-2 punch. You're seeing that develop more and more over the last probably year and a half. And I think that Goddard has really stepped into his own. He's a good blocker. I really like watching him in the screen game. The way that he can read the blocks in front of him after catching that short pass and being able to turn that into a first down a lot of the time has been really effective. And, he had a huge catch late in the game to move the chains downfield a little bit too yesterday. And you're right, he was featured heavily on one drive. And I think that shows you the level of confidence that Doug Peterson and Carson Wentz have in him. And we're going to have to see more of that. Like I said, I think with Ertz likely going down, I would be shocked if he played this week. Now, that being said, with the news about the ribs, he finished the game yesterday. And there is certainly something to be said where if you don't even throw him the ball, him being on the field requires attention. But But, yeah, look, Dallas Goedert has certainly allowed this offense to continue to grow. You mentioned two guys. Look, young guys get a lot of credit. Boston Scott, Greg Ward, rightfully so. And even J.J. Arcega-Whiteside had a great catch in the first play of the game yesterday. That was important. But I think that the offense is really running better because of guys like Goddard and Sanders that we've just talked about.
Scott, when you look at the defense, and I want to transition to Jim Schwartz because Grayson's great. It's findable 97.3ESPN.com. Talking with Scott Grayson, 97.3ESPN. Eagles insider. Scott, you've been critical of Schwartz, as I think a lot of us have been. You gave him an A for yesterday's game, and we talked about it to open the show. He's made adjustments yesterday. He stacked the box a little bit more. He disguised some coverages. It seems like he went for it a little bit, and we typically don't always see that from Coach Schwartz. So what did you think of his game plan and the defensive performance?
Well, you know, I went into it thinking that he had and been running a little bit of a vanilla kind of defense the last 2 weeks before to intentionally not show the Cowboys too much of what they were going to try to do. And that might have worked. I mean, they definitely did some things. But you could see the way they stacked the box. There was absolutely no respect for Dak Prescott. And they really, look, they gave Dak the opportunity. There were certainly throws that could be arguable, at least probably a dozen throws that Dak could have made to change the outcome of that game, including the one or two late in the game that could have gone for touchdowns had he been throwing those deep balls a little bit better. And he didn't make them. I mean, Jim Schwartz said, we're going to make you beat us, whether you have a bum shoulder or not. And they did a great job of stopping the run. I mean, everybody knew that was going to be a key to the game. You started seeing the Cowboys trying to find any way possible to get the ball in Ezekiel Elliott's hands. And, you know, even those short passes were covered up pretty quickly by the Eagles. So I thought they did a great job. And yes, I have been critical of Schwartz, as I know a lot of people have. And honestly, I think rightfully so. But the way that they were able to do what they did yesterday and keep that team out of the end zone, just, you know, nothing but a big pat on the back for me.
Scott, you have Malcolm Jenkins and Sidney Jones up here with an A, which is totally deserving. What did you think about Avonte Maddox? Because I thought he had a really strong game. He broke up a pass, and he made that big hit on Dak, which stopped them from getting a first down. So what did you think of Avonte Maddox?
Yeah, I thought Maddox, look, these guys that had to come in, we're starting to see a little bit of, everybody goes back to 2017, and here I am doing it too. But you go back to 2017, what happened? When guys came in key moments, they made plays. Avonte Maddox came in and took advantage of his opportunities. He made some plays. And, you know, you're right. He did deliver a big hit on Dak. It broke up a pass. And, you know, you could throw Sidney Jones into that category as well for coming into the game late and having to make a play. And he did. He saved the game there. Avonte Maddox, Sidney Jones, those guys who earlier in the year, quite frankly, struggled, had opportunities and struggled, and they got put back on the sideline. And now they're getting that chance after watching, after, you know, getting maybe some more of that hunger back to want to get back on the field. They're getting their chance due to some injuries in front of them or due to some opportunities, and they're taking advantage of them, and the team is benefiting. And that, quite frankly, is going to be what the team needs more of as they go through next week and potentially even into the playoffs. Avonte Maddox, Sidney Jones, two guys that I think definitely deserve a lot of credit too for taking advantage of the opportunities they had when their number was called.
I hate to go so negative here, but I will look at the D, and I see Jake Elliott's name there. How was he not an F? I couldn't believe those kicks.
He made the extra points.
Well, he made a 36-yarder.
I'm just teasing.
Quite frankly, I gave him the benefit of the doubt because I don't think there was any reason why Jake should have been put out there for that second 50-plus yarder. After you had the one that happened earlier in the game, and you're going to risk giving the Cowboys that. I put that one more on Doug than I did Elliott. But he was called to go out there and kick it. I think I wrote that in there that, you know, when your number's called, you got to go out there and do what you're asked to do. That being said, you know, his first kick from 50-plus wasn't great, and that one was even worse. But he shouldn't have been put out there in that situation. It was an 11-point game, in my opinion. And we can get into Doug with this one. 11-point game at that point, and you're kicking that and taking the risk of giving the Cowboys half a field to go for the opportunity to make it a two full possession game. I would have rather seen them punt that ball, put them in deep in the, you know, put the Cowboys deep when they're having trouble getting the ball downfield. Why give them any sign of hope with a short field by risking missing a field goal there? And that one, that's to me why I didn't give Jake an F and gave him a D, was I gave him the benefit of the doubt on that one, that he shouldn't have been put in that position.
If you think about it, Scott, there's three options there, right? There's go for it, there's punt and try to pin it, or there's try to kick the field goal. And I just gave you, I think, the hierarchy of normal decision making, and he went with the third. He eschewed one and two and went with the least. The most risky one there was. It made no sense to me.
Yeah, and I honestly expected him to go for it. My initial thought was, too. Well, knowing Doug and knowing that he hates to punt, and knowing the risk of missing a field goal, and like I said, going from 11 to 14 doesn't give you that much of a benefit. I expected him, for the way the Eagles were moving the ball, in that, I think it was, what, fourth and four?
Mm-hmm.
I kind of would have said that if I'm in Doug's head, it would have been go for it, punt, and then kick the field goal. And either way, no matter how you rank him, I think kicking that field goal in that spot was the third choice. And yeah, I was surprised that he took it there. You're right. There were several options, and I was surprised that he went with that one.
Yeah, and I'm happy that you gave Doug Peterson a C in such a big win, because that shows the ability to not be a prisoner of the moment, which we talk about all the time. And Doug, it's not like Doug coached a bad game, because a lot of those screens he designed and those worked really well. So there's a lot of good things that happened. You know, the Greg Ward catch was a really well-designed scissors route on the right, right side. But to go back to also the third and one and fourth and one, if you're going to go for it on third and one, knowing that you're also going to go for it on fourth and one, then third and one, you should at least try to make some guesswork there for the defense as far as pass or run. And he went empty backfield. It made no sense to me. You just told them you're going to pass and that you're going to pass again on fourth down.
Yeah, I didn't understand any of that. And then why Josh Perkins is the guy on fourth and one you're throwing. And I understand that might have been Zach Ertz on the initial play design. But you got to know, obviously, he's not in the game.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you're going for. I think you saw the biggest reason why they missed Jordan Howard at this point. That situation, to me, had Jordan Howard written all over it, and obviously he wasn't available to do that. And then you're right, empty backfield takes all the guesswork out of it for the defense. Just makes it so much easier on them. And I give – here's where I want to give Doug a lot of props, because like I said, you could see one team was clearly prepared for that game in the moment that game presented, and one team wasn't. And that team that wasn't had playing problems trying to get back to Dallas. I thought Doug did a great job of getting these guys ready to play. I mm-hmm. did, like you said, I liked the flow that you could kind of see a little bit of on the offensive play calling, throughout the game. But those moments, when you start talking about and looking ahead at if they win or if the Cowboys lose next week and the Eagles get in the playoffs, these mistakes can't happen from a coaching perspective, or it literally is the difference in moving on or going home. And I don't think Doug needs to be a little more careful with the way he decides to handle some of those moments within the game.
All right. Well, Doug Peterson will be aiming to get better grades from Scott Grayson after next week's game against
C's
the Giants.
Get degrees.
I'm sure that's his goal.
That is what the goal will be. And so that's our own Scotty Grayson. Scott, thanks so much for joining us. Great stuff. You got to catch his work on 97.3 ESPN.com. All the grades that he handed out. There's a lot of guys that we didn't get to, Greg Ward, Jim Schwartz, a lot of grades. And Scotty does a great job summing it all up. So make sure you go read it on 97.3ESPN.com. And, of course, Scotty will be back with us next Monday to give us the grades on Eagles-Giants. And we'll see what happens in that game. Take care, Scott.
All right. Happy holidays, guys.